In the previous episode, we learned what it means to develop applications with Azure Database for MySQL Flexible Server. In this episode and the next two, we will cover some detailed tutorials and demos. So first, let's get started by understanding how to connect and query Flexible Server using your applications. Here is a brief overview of what we will cover in this episode. In the first section, let's get our Flexible Server up and running and have the database ready for our application to connect to. And then let's get the required connection information. As you learned in the previous episode, you can use any of these languages and more, like Ruby, React, Go, C++, etc., to connect to Flexible Server. But in this episode, we will only cover tutorials to connect using PHP, Python, and Java. So we'll get our application environment ready, establish a connection from the application, and then do some basic CRUD operations on the database. And finally, and most importantly, let's clean up all the resources that are not required to make sure that you don't incur additional charges. So let's get started with the demo on how to get connection information from MySQL Flexible Server. If you have not created a Flexible Server already, refer to episode 4, use an Azure free account and create one. So I've already created a Flexible Server, a demo server episode 13 for this episode. You can create a resource from here if you haven't. There are three sets of information that you need to pick up from the Flexible Server. The first set is the connection information that includes your server name, your admin login name, and your password. If you've forgotten your password, just click on Reset Password and keep the password handy. Alternatively, you can also use the connection strings that are defined for each of the languages. You can just copy them from here. For example, if you're developing with .NET or maybe with JDBC, Node.js, etc., all you have to do is copy this and you're good to go. Next, let's look at the networking options. You can either choose public access or private access connectivity method while creating the database. Either case, make sure that your configurations are set correctly. For example, for public access, it's the firewall rules. For private access, it's the VNet and subnet details. In my case, I have chosen public access, allowed IP addresses, and I have set the firewall rules such that I've added my current IP address. You can add your own IP address, the IP address from which the application is going to connect to. And in case the application is in Azure service, then you just need to tick this to make sure that you allow connections from it. And finally, if you want to ensure a secure connection, download the SSL certificate and keep it in a path that is accessible by your application. And finally, make sure that your database is created and ready. You can either use development tools like MySQL Workbench or EXE, etc. Here we'll use the portal, create a DemoDB database with a UTF-8 character set, and click on Save. Now we are all set to connect from your application. Let's get started by connecting and querying using PHP. If you are more familiar and comfortable with Java or Python, you can feel free to skip to those sections. For PHP, make sure that you have it installed on your system. It could be PHP 7.4, 8.0, or 8.1. And then enable the MySQL I and OpenSSL extensions. In this sample set, we are going to use MySQL I extension. You can use PDO MySQL or MySQL ND as well. All you need to do is go to the php.ini configuration file and uncomment the extension equal to MySQLi and extension equal to OpenSSL, and you're good to go. Now let's look at some sample code for create table, insert, read, update, as well as delete. So the first step is to make sure that all your configuration details are stored in variables, the host name, username, password, database name, etc. In this sample, we will use procedural functions of MySQLi, MySQLi init, MySQLi connect, etc. You can also use object-oriented programming constructs and create a new MySQLi object and invoke methods like query or connect from it later on. So we will establish the connection using a MySQLi init. We will get the SSL configured by using MySQLi SSL set and pass the path to the downloaded SSL certificate. Then we'll use MySQLi real connect and pass all these variables onto it. Once that connection is successfully established, All you need to do is use MySQLi query, pass the connection object and a query string to it. In this case, it is a create table query. In the case of insert, you can actually use a prepared statement after establishing a connection. And in this prepared statement can be executed using a MySQLi statement execute. For read, you can use a MySQLi query and the result set that is obtained from it, you can just print it. For update, it's the same MySQLi statement execute that you can use like insert and the same with delete as well. At the end of each of these tasks, make sure that you close the connection. Let's quickly test if everything is working fine. Let's do a create table and insert some data into it. So we have actually inserted one record with a brand new product. Color is blue and price is 15.5. Let's update this record and update the price to 15.1 and then delete this record and see if that works as well. Perfect. That ends the demo for PHP. And now let's go on to look at how to connect and query using Python. In terms of prerequisites, install Python 3.7 or above onto your system and install the MySQL connector for Python using a simple pip install command. In the code, import MySQL connector first and store all the configuration details in a config variable. Also pass the path to the downloaded SSL certificate here. Then connect using a connect command and passing the configuration variable. And once that is successful, all you need to do is fetch the cursor using con.cursor and then use cursor.execute for all the queries that you want to execute, be it a drop table, create table, or insert into. Once you're done inserting the data, make sure that you commit, close the cursor, and the connection. The same goes with read, update, and delete. Once you establish a connection, just run cursor.execute. For reading, you might need to do a cursor.fetchAll to get the result set and then print that result set onto the screen. In case of update and delete, it is somewhat similar to the insert statement itself, where you will just run using cursor.execute and then commit that transaction. Let's quickly test it out. Let's create the table, insert three rows of data, and let's update the first record. You can see the updated value now. Let's delete the second record and see if it is deleted. Yep. That concludes the Python tutorial. Now let's learn how to connect and query using Java. In terms of prerequisites, you will need to make sure that you have JDK 8 or above installed and also install Apache Maven to build and manage your projects. Let's jump into coding the application. First, the pom.xml file which Apache Maven uses to build the projects. Here there are three things that you need to set correctly. First is the Java version. Second is the Apache Maven version, both compiler source and target. And the third, in dependencies, you need to set the MySQL connector for Java. This will be used to connect to MySQL databases. Let's look at the source files. In the source files, under the resources section, what is important is to add an application.properties file, which will have the URL, username, and password specified in it. The URL is basically a connection string. You could have directly picked this up from the Azure portal. But instead, you can just plug in the host name, the port name, as well as the database name here. Next, the schema.sql file, where you will put the entire database schema in. In this example, we only have one table. So that's the to-do table with four columns for ID, description, details, and a boolean to mark the to-do item done. But in your case, you would have more tables to fill in here. In your application Java file, here it is demo application.java, go to the main function and first load the application properties from the application.properties file that you specified under the resources section. Store all these properties in an object, here properties object, and you will use this object to establish a connection to the database in the next section. So you will send that properties object, use a get connection function, and retrieve the connection object. Once you have that, load the schema.sql file and create the database schema. Here you will need to do a create statement and then execute that statement. Next, let's look at how to insert, update, read, and delete data. First thing you need to have is a to-do object, which will hold the records from the database. So let's go ahead and create a new class for to-do, where you will specify an ID, description, details, and the same done, similar to the table that you created earlier. For insert, read, update, delete, we have separate methods created. So for insert, you just create a prepared statement, set the parameters, and then do an execute update. For reading data, however, you will probably need to use an execute query and get the result set and print it afterwards. Update data is similar to insert data, where you will use the same execute update, and the same with delete as well. Now let's test the working of this code. First, do an MVN compile to compile and build the project. Then use an MVN exec Java to run the application. So here you see that first it's establishing a connection, then it creates the database schema loading from the schema.sql file, and then you can see that the data is read correctly, it's updated correctly, and it's also deleted successfully. That ends our tutorial for Java as well. Finally, let's clean up the resources that are not required. Go to the Azure portal. There are two options for you here. Either you can stop the server and restart it later. You can save a lot of compute costs this way. Or you can go ahead and delete the server altogether if it was just for a testing purpose. You can also delete the resource group itself if it's not required for you anymore. And that's the end of this episode. Here are a few resources that you can refer to. There are a lot of quick starts and tutorials in the documentation as well as in the blog for you to get started. Thank you, and see you in the next episode.